Good afternoon, everyone. Welcome to this year's Schofield Memorial Lecture. I'd like to welcome alumni, emeritus professors, faculty, staff, students. Have I missed any family and friends, perhaps? My name is Gordon Kirby. I'll be master of ceremonies for the talk. I'd like to give, first of all, a little background on the Schofield, on Frank Schofield, and to whom this lecture has been dedicated, and then I'll give an introduction to today's speaker. So, the Schofield Memorial Lecture is dedicated to Frank Schofield, who was a very colorful and influential pioneer in veterinary medicine in Canada. Schofield immigrated from the UK in 1907 to enter the Ontario Veterinary College as a student. Soon after he graduated as a student, he traveled to Korea as a Canadian missionary, and he taught bacteriology there for a number of years. But he was very politically active, and his activities in defense of the Korean people who were currently being occupied by the Japanese led him to have to leave the country and return back to OVC in 1921, and where he taught for 33 years, and some of you knew him as a professor here, perhaps were taught by him or worked with him as a colleague. On his retirement, he returned back to Korea to work at the College of Veterinary Medicine in Seoul, and in recognition of his distinguished services to Korea's independence, he was actually the only foreigner to be buried in the National Patriots Cemetery there in Korea. So while Schofield had many significant contributions to veterinary research in the first half of the 20th century, undoubtedly the most important was his discovery of an antithrombin substance that was in spoiled sweet clover. And I actually pulled out the publication of in the Canadian Veterinary Record in 1922, in which he published an account of a brief account of a disease in cattle simulating hemorrhagic septicemia due to feeding sweet clover. And it actually makes quite an interesting read. You could sense his frustration in trying to understand what was going on. This was a major problem in agriculture and in farming in Ontario at the time, where castration and dehorning was causing death of calves that were being fed, as it turns out, moldy sweet clover. And his statement here, the relationship between sweet clover and the disease is the title of that section. This is a perplexing problem which has in some important aspects being impossible to solve. And I think he's quite humble in the fact that he actually identified the fact that, first of all, he recognized the relationship between feeding the clover and the disease. He reproduced the disease in rabbits. And in calves, he did a very brief experiment on three calves in which one calf was fed hay, another calf was fed moldy sweet clover, and a third calf was fed non-moldy sweet clover, and only the calf with sweet clover feed ended up dying. So it was quite a meticulous investigation of the disease. The other thing I just want to mention here is, to put it all into perspective, the article that follows his article is a study of horse versus tractor. Way overthinking at that time. So Schofield's discoveries weren't serendipitous or anecdotal, but based on, as I indicated, meticulous scientific inquiry and his systematic approach to veterinary science and his evidence-based campaign to promote best veterinary practice and improve health outcomes foreshadowed the acceptance of this approach in current dogma, both in human and in veterinary science and medicine. The Schofield Memorial Lecture celebrates Frank Schofield's life, his research, and his role as a motivational icon, which has undoubtedly inspired many subsequent research achievements here at OVC. Schofield provides us with the incentive to achieve the highest standards of effort, intellect, and ethics, and to provide evidence, to practice evidence-based medicine, to strive towards translation of our scientific discoveries into effective advances in both animal and human health. I'd like to welcome very much Dr. Jonna Mazet. Dr. Mazet received her DVM, MPVM, and PhD degree from the University of California Davis School of Veterinary Medicine, where she is a professor of epidemiology and disease ecology and the executive director of the One Health Institute there. Dr. Mazet focuses on global health problem solving, especially for emerging infectious disease and conservation challenges, including pathogen pollution, marine and coastal conservation, land use change, climate variability, and wildlife health. Dr. Mazet is active in international One Health research programs, most notably in relation to disease transmission among wildlife, domestic animals and people, and the ecological drivers of disease emergence. Currently, she is global director of a $175 million viral emergence early warning project named PREDICT that has been developed with USAID and the Emerging Pandemic Threats Program. She was elected to the U.S. National Academy of Medicine in 2013, one of the highest honors in health and medicine in the U.S. in recognition of her successful and innovative approach to emerging environmental and global health threats.
Thank you very much. It's such an honor to be here and to be here, I'm humbled by the amazing accomplishments of Dr. Schofield, and I can't live up to that. I might live up to the colorfulness. I don't know. Didn't meet the man. But I do like the colorful part, so can't also live up to comparisons of horses and tractors or the times there, but certainly all that he did in Korea and to continue to build the profession, it's very inspiring, and I'm lucky enough in my career to have experience working locally in the California system where I grew up, and now globally working in more than 30 countries. So I'll talk to you a little bit about that trajectory and you know, sort of where that's taken me. But I thought, because I was invited to speak to you a little bit about One Health, that I'd just give you all little props for the kinds of things that you do. I've had a wonderful day today meeting with graduate students and faculty, and everyone's been very generous with their time and have shared amazing stories about what they're working on. And it sounds very much to me like you all practice what I preach. I hope I practice it too. I think I do. But that is using One Health as an approach to problem solving. So I don't think of, and I don't think at Davis anyway, we think of One Health as a discipline. We think about it as sort of having two central tenets. One is collaboration. So the key part is recognizing that sort of our old system of going into our ivory tower and working alone in our lab is great, and we get some really good science done, but we're not solving problems unless we come together, talk to each other, share with each other. And to do that, we need to recognize and respect diversity across disciplines, speak some of the same languages, or at least learn each other's languages as we go, and really come together and address things more holistically. So that's the second tenet, is thinking about that holistic piece. How is it that animal, human, and environmental health are interconnected, and what can we learn if we start thinking about that holistically? And if we go all the way back, you know, people talk about One Health, it's the fad or whatever that's going now, and it always makes me smile because we named it something that caught on, and now we think of it as a fad, but it's what we've all mostly, most of you in this room have probably done for your whole career. So if we go all the way back, we can go back to Hippocrates if you want, and lots of us took an oath with that name in his name. So we can go all the way back to that concept And then if we start looking at zoonoses and the concept, we can see that veterinarians have really been involved with that since the beginning. And I'm lucky enough to have been trained at Davis, as was mentioned, and we had Calvin Schwabe, who was also an early pioneer of this concept. He called it one medicine, and I think that that was a good term. It didn't stick as well as one health sticks, and maybe it's because we want to be healthy, and medicine invokes vertebrate health, right? And it doesn't invoke the environmental piece. So that's probably why we're talking more about one health. So again, bringing disciplines together, these are just some samples of disciplines that we can bring together, but bringing disciplines together, the ones that we need to address problems. And when you do that, you start to explore more deeply things like drivers that might be in the background. It may not be the way you design your study specifically to deal with every single influence and driver that might be out there, but it helps you to start broaden your perspective because you're in the room with the different folks that are thinking along those lines. So I guess partly for me, practicing One Health and thinking about it has enriched me immensely because I'm constantly learning from my colleagues. So I'm just a sponge. So I guess I felt like when I was a grad student, I was a sponge now, but then I'd get it and I wouldn't have to sponge it up anymore. And I guess it's just so wonderful to figure out that it's okay not to know everything and not to be the smartest person in the room. And it's okay to say, wow, I don't know, but you're interesting. I want to learn from you. So that's what I think One Health helps us do. I've listed some common things that we use the One Health approach on. I'm unfortunately not going to be able to talk about all those today, but some of the folks that I've worked with in coastal pathogen pollution and looking at climate and things like that are here with you in your college, and they, I know, have given talks and can give more. Folks that I've been working with on One Health issues in Africa surrounding endangered species like mountain gorillas are here, and I know are esteemed members of your faculty, so you have all of that. So I'll go and tell you a little bit more about the thing that's kind of the crazy thing that we're doing now. And that is, we heard about this challenge. You know, all of us in the room, we have to respond and write grants, right? And we have to get the funding to do the good work that we do. And we saw this challenge, a whole bunch of folks that I know that were all working in the realm saw this challenge. Let's please write us a proposal to stop at their source the first stages of emergence of zoonotic diseases. Oh, by the way, before you know it's a disease, that pose a significant threat to public and animal health. Again, you don't know it's a disease. You don't even know what you're looking for and whether it'll be a pathogen. And if you do a really good job, there won't be any more emergence, and no one will know you did a good job. So you're completely out of work as soon as you do that. So that was a crazy challenge, and I guess that what really happened was there were a group of us out there that had been working some along the lines of looking in wildlife and looking for viruses and things like influenzas that were in wildlife hosts that we knew had the opportunity to jump, right? To jump into our food supply, into livestock, to jump into humans. And so we thought, if we don't take on this challenge, people who might not do it as well or be as open to all the other pieces from a One Health perspective might win that big grant. So we decided, crazy or not, and I can tell you crazy, that we decided to go ahead and build a consortium to bid for this project. And it was based on the idea that you could have this zoonotic pool of viruses out there in wildlife. So if we look historically, most emerging infections are zoonotic, and most of those come from wildlife. People go, wow, why is that? Well, it's just because we haven't hung out with wildlife as long as we've hung out with other things. So we are sort of more innately experienced now, evolutionarily, with human pathogens, right? And pathogens of those animals, companion animals that we hang out with a lot, domestic animals, especially those that we eat. So it makes sense that what's left to emerge is most likely to be, or the biggest diversity of those things is in wildlife. wildlife hosts. So if we think about wildlife hosts, they may be susceptible to those viruses, or those might be part of their now endemic flora and don't even make them sick. So you may have some little outbreaks, if you will, when there's a jump from wild animal species to wild animal species, or even if there's stress or immunocompromisation in a species that has grown with that virus. But it's really, we notice it, right? Because we don't really have a global infrastructure to pick up wildlife disease. There's a lot of us here in the room that have been working on that a long time, but even here in Canada or at home in California for me, we don't have people all over just waiting and able to run out and respond to those outbreaks. So we usually miss them, frankly. The animals get scavenged, we usually miss them. So when you pick it up is when there's a spillover into our food supply, domestic animals, or directly into people, or there's a amplification here that spills over here, which is probably like what we see with MERS most recently. So the goal was to say, okay, if we got better at looking right here and knowing what was out here, could we move the epidemic curve from up here back to here and have opportunity for control? If we know what's out there before it spills over, and we have the capacity, the tools to pick it up and detect it, because we kind of know what we're looking for, will we respond faster? And so why really would USAID want to do that? Well, they want to do that because they're spending a lot of money. I think they had wonderful, good people, well-meaning people, humanists, if you will, but also on a practical level, they were spending a lot of money. On what? On vaccine, okay? So they're spending a lot of money on vaccine. That's what our U.S. Agency for International Development, one of the things that it does is when there are outbreaks, they run to that place with a whole bunch of vaccine. And mostly they were finding they were getting there just in time for the thing to be over, and now they have all this vaccine. So they're vaccinating a whole population of people who may never get even exposed to that pathogen again. So big waste of money, looks like a big Band-Aid, because it is, right? We want to do something for you, but we know this thing's just about burnt itself out and we're bringing you vaccine. Or even after they had decided to do this project, the H1N1 outbreak started, right? And it took until the influenza is probably what we're the best at making new vaccines for, because we do that every year. And when H1N1 outbreak started, it took a whole year, and a quarter of the world's population was already exposed and infected before we even had enough vaccine to cover 20% of the world. And where is that vaccine going to go? It's going to go here, and it's going to go in my hometown. It's not going to necessarily go where the hottest spots are. For the need. So that's really USAID's motivation. And then if we put it in context of how much does this stuff cost, well, how much does it cost us not to do that? The World Bank calculated that it cost $80 billion to respond to 6 outbreaks. That's pre-Ebola, the pre-Ebola outbreaks, ones that you don't even think of as really huge that don't hit our press. And that $6.7 billion a year could be saved if we were out in front of these things and we didn't see zoonotic disease outbreaks. So we really need to get to a place where we're prepared, we can prevent, either we can predict or we could stop at the source when these things happen. And so this is the consortium we put together, and all of the partner countries we work, almost all of our teams in the countries where we engage are citizens of those countries that lead the project. And so we have hundreds of people working on this project in about 35 countries now. We're sort of scaling back. There's a lot going on. I might move here too, like Dr. Schofield. Don't ask me tomorrow how many countries, I don't know. But we still have talented people all over the world that I hope I can help pay so they can feed their families really soon. Okay, so we developed this sort of iterative approach. So we model the systems, we look at history, we do the best we can, and what does the modeling show us? It shows us that we have really bad data. So I was talking to folks today, someone asked me a very smart question, how do you predict, you know, they USAID named the project PREDICT. I did not. I wouldn't have probably chosen that. But you're supposed to predict things. How do you make, you know, basically what our government wants is they want me to give them a weather forecast. On Tuesday, in Dar es Salaam, there will be 3 cases of hemorrhagic fever. You know, I can't do that, okay? Nobody can do that. But I can say that there are lots of factors that we can measure that contribute to that, that increase the likelihood. So just like, I don't know, it probably said 40% rain today or 60% rain today. It rained a little, right? Maybe, I don't know, was it? I was only out part of the time. But we're not surprised when we look at the sky. Yeah, that looks like about right. That's a good percentage. Well, it took about 100 years of data to get us to the place where we can now predict the weather. 50 good years, at least, of data to predict the weather. So we can't just say, please go predict that when no one's ever looked. No one's ever tried to figure out where the viruses are, what might come next, and what are those factors that really stimulate them from spilling over. And I think in the virologic community, there's been wonderful, wonderful work that does look at sort of the human ecological context around how viruses get spread from person to person and how people interact and all of that. But often they leave out the animal side and the environmental side. And so we're trying to bring that into the piece. So once we did the modeling, knew that we had crap, sorry to my colleagues on the team that do the modeling, we then moved into identifying key species and interfaces to target, because you can't just sample everywhere, right? So we had to start doing that. What does that mean? Oh, by the way, more literature review, more modeling to figure that out. But we also had to build the plane while we were flying it, because we were on a clock from a funder that said, where's the data? It's year one. I would like a report. And actually, anybody who wants USAID funds, we can talk about it. It's worth doing, but they don't want a report once a year. They want a report once a week. So we could talk about that too. So it's a whole different thing. When we got the award, they asked me when I was moving to Washington, D.C. I'm like, I have a job here. I'm supposed to teach and do some things. So we had to figure that out. So we sort of intuitively went for the interfaces and the species while we were doing the math. And while we were looking at it from multiple different sides, using epidemiologists, using ecologists, letting them make their own models, comparing them, then doing them together. Thankfully, intuition was right, and all of the stuff sort of came out the same, pretty much. There's little pieces of differences. And then we had to do the pathogen detection and discovery. I hate to say pathogen or even viral discovery. The virus has been around a long time. It's not like, wow, we found this brand new thing that just emerged. Well, perhaps every once in a while there's a mutation that changes something enough that we would say that it's new. But more likely these things have been around thousands to millions of years and been evolving, and we just finally saw them, right? We found them. But that required molecular identification in sort of the least developed countries in the world. And how do you get that done? And is it ethical to zoom into a country and take their resources, which include their samples, and fly it back to your country and do all the work, and they get none of the credit or the development or any of that? So we had to think about that whole piece. And then get that information into the hands, the policymakers, the citizens, people like you, to do more work with it was another challenge. So we sort of picked that up. And I can go through network analyses if you want me to, but I won't because I don't have time, to show you how we picked primates, bats, rodents. But still, that was where our focus was in the first few years of PREDICT, and still is. But we couldn't leave out birds and pigs and carnivores and ungulates, because we live close with them and we interact with them. Here is a network analysis that I will show you. So all the reds are zoonotic viruses, okay? All the zoonotic viruses found to date, and they are swelling. Those individual viruses are swelling and getting bigger when they're transmitted through more than one interface that we could find in the literature. So the direct transmission interfaces are in one color, I think green, and indirect are in, well, indirect are in green, I think, and direct are in blue there on this version. But as you see the interfaces swell, that means they're connected to more than one virus, okay? So if we have big fat interfaces, we know that those are very common and we should be looking there. All right. We also start to see a pattern of which things can be transmitted in multiple different scenarios, and we start to worry about those viruses and potentially their cousins, if you will, in their viral families even more. One of the things that this helped us do was we had been sort of told to leave vector-borne out. So we didn't leave it out altogether, but the reason we were told to leave vector-borne out is there was funding going through other mechanisms, especially through our US CDC, to really study vector-borne well. So it wasn't good money to pay lots of people to do all the same thing. So other folks were doing vector-borne. Luckily, that makes sense because it's actually quite different way you would go about it. So we still test for vector-borne, but we don't target to pick up vector-borne. And this helped us feel okay about that. So when we targeted interfaces, we started working with the teams in the countries and recognizing that we could look for interfaces that are in the literature, but the interfaces in the literature are probably really old, right? How long does it take you to get your papers published? Don't go 6 weeks, right? So often papers take years to get finished and written up the way you want them and submitted and through the peer review process. So we could do the best we could to get started looking at interfaces from the literature, but we had to think about the local context and think about the people who live and work there who know often a heck of a lot more about the interfaces than the people that actually wrote those papers, and sometimes were guessing later when they wrote them up with their own cultural context in mind. So we got with our teams in the countries and visited places, and they told us, hey, there's clandestine markets over here. That could have been what was in this paper that was told to be highway building, but it's really that they have a bushmeat market under the bridge that they built. Okay, so it's not that they built the bridge, it's that they put a bushmeat market underneath it. So we had to do that kind of ground truthing. One of the cool things that we found in that process is that bat guano farming was really exploding. And sure, we knew there was such a thing as bat guano farming and that it was probably risky, but until we were in the field and working with our teams, we didn't recognize the rate of change and explosion of bat guano farming. So if you build a bat a condo, it will come. Okay, so they'll come right out of the forest and hang out here because it's nicer digs. They like a luxury condo, then they will defecate on tarps for you and you can sell it as fertilizer. You can also be exposed to fresh bat guano, which we now know has a lot of things in it you might not want to be exposed to. Maybe, I'm just saying. So then we're faced with this going, maybe getting UV disinfected. So these guys are infected, but maybe most of the food supply is okay because maybe there's enough UV, but who knows? Let's test that, right? Let's figure that out. If people are going to practice this new economic endeavor, shouldn't they know the risk? And shouldn't they be given the information on how to do it as safely as possible and or alternatives that might be less dangerous to their health? So that's kind of the stuff. This is Kathmandu. When I go there, my food comes from here, right? So we need to think about that. This is food supply issue. Most emerging infectious diseases start with a food issue, right? So most of the Ebolas and things that we see start with a food issue. Somebody eats something, plays with something, puts it in their mouth. It's usually a food issue. So we got on the train, if you will, and started to look at the high-risk interfaces as well as the large-scale ecological drivers while we were designing and doing the project at the same time. And so that was an interesting process of data consistency. We really could figure out that we could do the best possible work we could with the modeling and in the field, but this laboratory side was super tough because, again, we were working in places that maybe we couldn't find a PCR machine or a sequencer in the country. In fact, in one country, they told us for sure they didn't have a sequencer in the country, and we found it in their crime lab. So the national police, their effective FBI had one. But they never used it. But they let us use it. So the other thing I think about wildlife people, I come from a foundation of wildlife health, and then sort of animal health people in general, is we're really scrappy. So we can do a lot with a little. I don't know if anybody had to do a lot with a little. Yeah. So USAID kept saying, how did you do that? That would have cost 10 times the amount or 20 times the amount. I'm like, yeah, well, we MacGyver it. We figure out how to do it cheaper and for free and get people to give us stuff. You know, so even though the grant's a big dollar amount, we're not wasting it. We got lots to do. That's not enough to do what you told us you wanted us to do, and do it well. So I'm just going to really quickly, as an example of what you can do, I'm going to go over some of the first 5 years' achievements. So we're just starting year 8. So we've been going at this for 7 years, and I'll tell you some of the changes after the first cycle, the first five-year cycle. But in the first cycle, we were able to train people and get them up to speed, develop all the protocols for sampling all different species of wildlife safely, not hurting the wildlife while we're doing it, not putting the people at risk, getting cold chain, getting biosecure measures of way to pack and ship and work in the laboratory, getting laboratory protocols up to be able to detect. We were able to sample 56,000 animals in the first 5 years. And we had to develop some new techniques to do that, and did some good scientific work based out of zoos and primate centers to be able to figure out how do you get the best bang for your buck if you have to throw a primate a rope and you can't actually catch them in every situation. And can you get virus, and can you get what's actually in there? So anesthetizing them and comparing it to just throwing them the rope and seeing if we get the same virus both ways, and which attractants. This is strawberry jam, their favorite there in Rwanda. But in Nepal, they like peanut butter. So I'm just saying. And which ones have inhibitors for PCR later, and all of that kind of work. And then get labs up and running that look just like your labs here, right? And that's no small feat. And so probably I think I'm most proud of the lab capacity. And again, going back to scrappiness in Tanzania, our teams, we said, hey, we'd love to get this work done, but we're going to need to move out of the teaching laboratory, the microbiology teaching laboratory. We can't bring the world's most deadly pathogens in when you're doing lab, you know? So we're going to have to figure this out. And they said, no problem. I said, I can't build anything. I have no money to build anything. No problem. Can we equip it? We can equip it. Okay, no problem. They built a lab by stacking shipping containers on top of each other. It's the most beautiful lab. It's the equivalent probably to my multi-million dollar lab in Davis. They built it for 40 grand. And it has granite countertops and marble floors, oh, by the way, because those things are not as expensive there. There you go, see the granite countertops. But it has all the right divisions for making master mix where you're supposed to make it, and all good flow and all of that in this very economical way. So we did develop conventional PCR protocols to viral families and genera rather than going for specific viruses, because again, we're looking for viral discovery, if you will, or new detection of viruses, while we also wanted to pick up known viruses at the same time. So we went through all of the viral families that have caused outbreaks in people that could be zoonotic, and we put together primer sets. Now, we get when you go to a conserved sequence, you get a lot of noise, so we have to clone and sequence all of those fragments and go through phylogenetics to make sure what we're finding is what we think we're finding. So you have to do it rigorously, because you can't go to a government and say you have Ebola and really you have some new filovirus that you didn't know about it before. That's not a real example. Don't quote me. But I think I'm proudest of the training. So in the first in the first 5 years, we targeted 34 laboratories to do this work in 20 countries. Six of those labs, when we started, had some capacity. They could run conventional PCR. 28 had no capacity, really, to do this work. And by the end of the 5 years, we had 27 of the laboratories running our protocols. So that means they were detecting and potentially diagnosing virus in their country when they had never done it before. So to me, that is the biggest global immune system, is that they can detect then, instead of waiting months for foreign entities to come in in and export samples and then get things detected outside of their country. So to me, this was the biggest piece, but it's not as sexy as the viral findings. So we ran over 400,000 tests on those early samples. And we did pick up over 800 new viruses, never before seen. Again, just in those zoonotic families, over 30 known pathogens at the same time using that platform. Now, we also run metagenomic techniques side by side, so we do a subset, and we find a lot of virus that way too. We often find different viruses with the metagenomic technique working a little better for some viral families, but the conventional PCR, actually, we found the most virus and the most diversity doing it because the conventional PCR was a little bit more sensitive. So we're sort of combining those techniques in this next phase. And they were bad actors, right? We're finding the bad ones, if you will, or what we think might be the bad ones. But just because we find them, how do we start to rank them and figure that out? What's really happening? We also found ones we knew about, but we helped to advance the science. So 10 years after the SARS epidemic, we were able to find hosts of SARS-like, effectively actually SARS, that was transmissible to humans in the host that we thought they were in, instead of the host that they spilled over and amplified in. So most people know the civet, bat to civet story, but we were able to detect in the field. So we were able to advance the science. So even though a lot of what we're doing seems like low-tech work that maybe some laboratories and universities would be like, yeah, that's too far down, but we're able to get, you know, papers in Science and Nature and things like that. So in the first 5 years, we had 120 peer-reviewed publications out of the project. Good productivity. I'm not a co-author on very many of those at all. Too bad. Like that, being PI doesn't make them put you. No, I don't. I would never do that. But it is super great to see the productivity and coming out of the countries again where we're working, where they're just starting to get this kind of work up and going, and having them as primary authors or co-authors is also a huge measure of success. We were able to find things like MERS-like coronaviruses in different hosts and in different areas of the world. So even though we hadn't necessarily released all that information to the public, we were able to tell the global public health community, okay, that virus that you just found and sequenced, we found near neighbors to that or things in these hosts, in these countries, you might want to address that with your surveillance and detection plan. So you might want to broaden your scope of where you're looking to try and figure out what's going on there. Oh, and that's Bakwana Farmer. Too bad. We were also able to advance and take the loop fully back, if you remember that schematic, to the models and start to improve the models and do some niche modeling and get more detailed, better models. So we could do things like model the distribution of the MERS-like coronavirus bat reservoirs, overlay that with camel production, which seems to be the amplifying and transmitting host for most of these situations, and then make a hotspot map for future MERS spillover, as well as talk to the people in the communities we're working about drinking camel milk raw and things like that. So that it helps you to get down into the details. We were able to help governments get them trained to do their own surveillance when they were ready to do it, even though we weren't working in the Middle East when we started. And then on, again, back to my foundations, being excited and interested in conservation outcomes. So we were able to continue to illustrate that it's not just worrying about viruses spilling over from animal hosts into people and making us sick and sort of vilifying the animals, but oh, by the way, our viruses are spilling over, very human viruses that are only circulating in humans, and that strain of that year killing things like endangered species. So we were able to pick those things up as well. And discover new viruses in great apes. And then we could refine our hotspot map. And so this hotspot map is much less red. There are fewer hotspots because we continue to refine and say, okay, we start to see what the drivers are and what's most consistent. And we see the things that were in earlier hotspot maps about human population and mammalian diversity are still in there. But what's starting to come up as most important or as important is population change, and change of land use. So not just that you've destroyed the forest, but you're actively changing it. Maybe you're even greening and going back to a greener use, like taking an urban area back into an agricultural area. But that process of change is very stressful to the ecosystem, and we see issues when that happens. We also helped governments respond to 23 outbreaks, because you're there, you're doing this work, you're working with the governments, you know that they know that's what you do, so you will get asked to help. And so we were happy to be involved and saw an evolution in the way that folks were responding to outbreaks, all the way from jumping out of their silos and getting funding mobilized more quickly because they understood that they couldn't hold money just for Ebola over here and Shigella over here and yellow fever over here and wait until there was a diagnosis and then do the response because they knew what silo to pull the money from. So we saw changes like that. We also saw folks being excited to preemptively add protocols to their outbreak response to include environmental evaluation and animal contact, not just human to human contact. So that was super exciting to see that evolution happen as well. And then we get the information as fast as we can and as good as we can back out to the public. So this is our health map interface. You can reach it by data.predict.global, or you can go to healthmap/predict if you want to find the site. And you can look, and there you can zoom in, and there all of our surveillance data from the first 5 years, and now the next cycle starting to come up as well, is there. And you can click on either the surveillance a layer and see how many animals and what species we sampled in each location. You can click on the preliminary test results and you can see where we found virus and what we named the virus. And if the viruses are already in GenBank, because we try to get everything into GenBank as fast as we can, then you can click. This is one that shows click here and it links you out to the GenBank site. So that's a sort of our public interface so that people can access our data. And so now we're in a conundrum. So now we have these 1,000 viruses, so it's up to about 1,000 viruses now. So now we have 1,000 viruses, and which ones are the bad ones and which ones are who cares ones? I don't know. I should know. I thought there might be some papers to help me with that, but there really aren't. Because nobody tried to do that before. It's your own fault for going out and looking for viruses. So now we have to put that together. What is that risk ranking? How do you do that? And so we're, instead of looking just at virologic factors, which have been done, and some of them panning out to be helpful, but most of them panning out to be not so helpful, unless it's a well-studied virus, then they're really good. But we don't find a lot of well-studied viruses when we go out and look for new ones, right? So we have to figure in the ecological context as well as the epidemiologic factors. So if ecologically there's something happening to an ecosystem over here, and that ecological factor would make you think, well, that fits the model, that's going to be red, but no people are going there, so there's no real option for people to interact with the host there, then epidemiologically there's no opportunity for transmission. So we need to put all of those factors together, and I hope to put something out to the scientific community in the next year or so that will show about 30 parameters that we now put into the mix to say what is going to be the top of the list anyway. If we have 1,000 viruses, what 100 should we be watching? And why weren't we watching Zika when we probably knew a lot more about why it should have been on the list, but we just never made that list, right? So we're putting that together, and I hope to have your feedback as a community just to start discussion and start to improve the way that we do that kind of work. So we're looking at viral traits and interfaces and ecological drivers to help us with that as well. So not only where we go looking for viruses, but then how we rank them for risk. We also changed from the first 5 years to this current 5 years into triangulating. So not just what viruses might be out there, but then who's sharing them. Okay, so one of the things that is featuring heavily in our ranking, if you will, is the species or host range, and what we call host plasticity, the ability of the virus to jump from host to host, okay? That seems to be very important as a predictor of whether or not later that virus can infect people, and even probably more important than that, whether it can go human-to-human transmission and spread. We also want to know the distribution of the host. We want to know the global geographic distribution and the niche distribution, so we can understand how to mitigate risk and how do you put together your messages on that. So looking for that early recognition, but also, are sick people getting these viruses and they're going undiagnosed? Are healthy people getting these viruses? That's important too, because maybe then that gives us more information in the absence of pathology. I miss all my pathologist colleagues, but in this context right now, we're not able to make that happen. We keep sort of pushing and hoping. People like Dale are helping in certain places. But really just to start to think about all of those pieces and the viral sharing. We also look at occupational risk and whether or not those people like under the back guano farm are getting exposed, and are they reacting? Are they developing a serologic reaction to the things that we're finding in the guano? And then finally, we start to look at behavior. So human behavior around these things, like is it easier to tell a mom to tell their kids not to play with a dead bat than it is to tell that same family to disregard their cultural traditions of thousands of years of washing a dead body and kissing a dead body, right? Where do you want to stop these things? Can you stop it earlier before it's out of control by choosing a more palatable intervention point? And so we're working on that now. So we're bringing social scientists into the fold, behavior change experts into the fold. And again, I get to be a sponge and really absorb and learn from those folks with different expertise. So really, this can happen. You could do this. You can get out there and you can find virus. Shock, right? If you look, you'll find it. But then you want to move to this proactive piece. And this is what's, I'm going to say, happened to me lately, is that I didn't know like that these things just take on a life of their own. You know, I've been in science for a long time, and I felt like I've mostly been convincing people why they should do something. And now I'm in the situation of people coming and saying, why don't you do that globally? And shouldn't we be looking more than just bats and non-human primates and rodents? Shouldn't we be looking at all of the animals and finding all of the viruses? Well, I don't know. Should we? If we can, should we? Should we get to a place where we have more information about the host range and the geographic range and all of those pieces? Could that down the road lead us to understand better which things should be targeted for vaccines? How we might find subunit vaccines that work for more than one virus so they're economically viable to create? I don't know. But I can tell you now that there's a lot of people that think we should. That we need to turn the way that we deal with viral epidemics and pandemics on their head. And if you really get into it, there are only about 6,000 viral species that are known, and those infect things other than mammals. About 590 of those are from mammals, depending, this is ICTV recognized, accepted viruses. And about 30 to 40% of those are zoonotic. So if you use those numbers, you're going to come up with, they're probably skewed to more zoonotic than are really in the whole population, right? Because we study things that go into humans more than we study other things. But still, that means we can try to get to a place where we understand what might be out there. So this spillover stuff is happening more. It's not just that we're looking for it more and finding it more. It's really happening more at the acceleration of lots of things like climate. So we're sort of in this situation of not having a strategy for something we know is coming. So we're trying to get ahead of that. And so with our work on PREDICT, we've been able to do some things like figure out how many viral species might be in a single host, at least in a single location. By intensively sampling a host at a certain location, we can pick up where that curve of viral detection and discovery starts to saturate. So it's the first time we could actually say what might the real rigorous sample size be to try and pick up all of those viruses. So in tropis bats, we discovered 55 new viruses out of 9 viral families by just looking for using that consensus PCR for those 9 viral families. And we could tell by mark recapture techniques using the viruses that we were probably missing 3. That we were saturating the curves, but we were probably missing 3. And so if we extrapolate that to all terrestrial mammals, now I'll just tell you, we also did this with macaques. We also included metagenomics to come up with, make sure we were doing it right. We came out that there are probably 1.3 million unknown viruses in about the 24 viral families that we would be interested in that might jump from animals to people. Now, not all of those are going to be zoonotic, right? So we had that 30 to 40%. So there's about 500,000 unknown viral zoonoses out there. So if we just keep working on the same ones, it's no wonder we keep missing the ones when they come, right? Because we're always chasing. So what do you do? Well, you can start to narrow the window. And you can start to reduce the hosts again if you want to, if you want to save money. Or you can reduce the geographical range, again, based on your models as to those places that fit the likely spillover and all of those things. Or you can just figure out what it costs and tell policymakers, which is what we did. So doing that same thing, we can figure out that actually it would cost about $6.4 billion to discover all of those viruses. But about half of that money goes into the end of the tail of the curve. So as you've found most of the viruses, the ones that are more and more rare and harder to find are out in the tail. So for about $3.4 billion, you can discover almost all of them. So you get some value there. And also, as you go, technologies get better because you're doing it, right? So there are all sorts of other added benefits for conservation. If you're getting your hands on all the hosts, then you know a lot more about all those hosts and their genetics and all of those things. So the cost is really about probably between $3 and $5 billion to do that. And should you do that? Well, that's a lot of money. But guess what? It's a lot less money than we're spending now. So the World Bank estimates that our annualized every year cost, when you spread it out over the years instead of spending it all at one time on big outbreaks, is about $35 million a year. Billion dollars a year, sorry. And so we could do this project over 10 years for $340 million a year. And so it's cheaper. It's cheaper than one big response that could cost, they say, for a big flu response is going to cost us $3 trillion. Okay, hopefully we won't have one. But even this is much cheaper than we ended up spending on Zika. Okay, and so we can do this well, too. Then we have to overlay all the mammalian species to figure out how many animals we have to see. We want to look at water birds as well. We don't want to leave flu out. We can start looking at where those are, how much it would cost to do that. And it comes out about the same. And then the future, you know, I don't know what the future is, but I do know that people are starting to think, you know, we keep naming things that we keep doing the same thing. But planetary health is out there now, and we've got a whole nother group of colleagues that are gathering around planetary health. So let's embrace them and bring them into the fold and embrace the planet, if you will, as our patient, instead of what many of us embrace as an individual animal, some of you even an individual cell or mechanism, and then what many like me, epidemiologists, think of as a population. But now we have the opportunity to think even bigger than that. So that's it. Questions? Yeah? Do we have a couple minutes? Yeah. Good. No. Yeah. Yes, ma'am.
So I wonder, does this setup have potential for detecting viruses that are currently under control or endemic, but may switch, like acquire a pathogenic factor and then reemerge as a outcome?
Yeah. So definitely. That's for those of you who might not be able to hear, she's asking whether or not the system allows for you to pick up change, right? To pick up a change in an endemic virus, a mutation. So certainly it does. Part of the idea is then that policymakers like the idea that you could finish, there's a start and a finish, but really we know in life, things continue to change. But if you go out and you collect most of the work, most of the samples get most of the work done, guess what you do? You train people over that period that are now interested, some in a specific host, some in a specific virus or viral family, some in the whole big picture. So they're going to keep doing their career. So we train graduate students and twin faculty members in all of these locations. Many of our headquarters in the countries are at universities. So they are not going to stop. They keep writing extra research grants and keep going. So certainly while we're working at it, we'll be able to detect those changes, especially as we get into sequencing more and more. So now we do full genome sequencing of all the coronaviruses and influenza viruses that we pick up, but we don't have sort of enough cash at the moment to do full genome sequencing for everything. But as the techniques get cheaper and easier, we're going to that more and more. So we will be able to detect big changes and little changes. Thanks. Yes.
5 years from now,
yeah.
If I end this virus,
yeah.
And you're pretty sure it's the next big pandemic.
Mm.
Your modeling tells you.
Okay. It's unlikely. I would put it I would have it at a high place on the list, but I probably will never feel confident enough to say that's the next one. But okay, I'm following you. Yeah, I'm playing.
So tell me what the world does with it.
Okay, great question, because a lot of folks are saying, yes, yeah, so what? We know about Ebola and we've done nothing about it. We know flus are coming, we try and we still can't do much about it. So I think, one piece is we watch them better and we know where they are and where they're likely to spill over and cause disease so that when that happens, we're ready. We also have general best practices, good hygiene, all those kinds of messages that we under-deliver. And so in high-risk communities where we think that virus is, we really hit it hard with behavior change and education for the communities. And we help their physicians, clinicians, and laboratories know that this is something they should have on their list. So we found one, for example, in DRC that was associated with dead people and their nurses. So DRC put that virus on their surveillance list. Which it's a virus, it's a one-off so far. It's the only place we found it associated with dead people. So maybe it was the cause, maybe it wasn't, because again, no pathology, maybe it was an incidental finding, but that we found it in spouses and nurses and things makes it more likely that it was at least circulating at the time that the guy got sick and died, right? So people put it on their surveillance list. I guess the biggest thing I think, again, as we go, which is not the sexy thing and nobody likes me to say it, but I think it's true, is that we get the labs ready. And frankly, I was in the hospital for 2 weeks with 104 fever and my physician in Davis, California couldn't diagnose it. So, and that was before I was doing this, but my vet friends were still taking my blood and sneaking it out of the hospital. Where are you taking that tube, madam? Nowhere, going to the veterinary diagnostic lab. So it is an issue. People be ready to be looking for hopefully the right things. So combination of education, prevention, but I think bigger than that, as we have a huge atlas of the viral diversity that we're interested in, and we continue to refine the risk structure around that, we get better and better, right? Our models for hotspots, our ability to be a little more like the Weather Service and say, this is here, somebody's tearing down the forest right there where we found those bad ones. Really, we can get in there. We've even worked with the extraction industry folks to say, if we had the tools to say, you're choosing between these two places to build a dam, we'd rather you not do that, but you could build it here, would be less risky to your workers and people downstream than here. So that's kind of how we use it. Mm-hmm. Yes?
Why did you zero in on bats? Is it because we sort of, you know, nothing about bats? Do we just never see them because they're only out at night? Or is there something special about bats that they have more viruses, they're more likely to be sources of MERS or SARS or HENDRA or whatever?
So understudied is one. They're understudied, and they have a huge, in the mammalian order, they have a huge amount of diversity. So so there's a huge amount of diversity that's unstudied there. They also tend to adapt and live easily with people. So they live in houses, so they have higher exposure to people. So there's a lot of, you know, people walk under huge fruit bat roosts to go to work every day in Kathmandu, for example. So, and in fact, interestingly, when I was asking people, do you have bats here? And looking at them hanging in the tree above them, they say, no, we have no bats here, right? So people either choose to ignore them because they're creepy, or they actually don't see them. They said, oh, you mean the birds that fly at night? Yeah, we have birds. So that's one piece, is just their ability to adapt to us and to stay where we are. Then their ability to migrate long distances so they can spread things over time. And then some of my viral colleagues will tell you, virology colleagues will tell you that there's something about flight. So there's something about flight, because we see it in birds with flu as well, that is possibly the immune system, possibly it's simply metabolism, and I don't think we know what it is yet, but there's a strong component of scientists, smart people, that think there's something about flight that allows them to host more diversity in individuals. So when we look at our findings to date, we find more bats with multiple, for example, coronaviruses, than we find primates with multiple whatever other viruses. So they seem to harbor more viruses per individual, or be shedding more viruses at the same time, which is pretty interesting. Yes?
So how do you think health behavioral change from a preventive perspective is notoriously difficult? Mm-hmm. And then you combine it with something like doing so in a culturally appropriate and what's in that. Mm-hmm. What does prediction do? Because following a hate question, mm-hmm. so you find the next big thing on people, mm-hmm. but you think it could be. How is that, like, what are their priorities?
Right. Yeah. So right now we're doing big sort of behavioral surveys. As we take the samples from people, we also ask them lots of questions until they fatigue of us about how they interact with animals and their environment and each other. Then we do observational research with focal follows, small group work, ethnographic interviews. So we use all the skills that we can get from our social science colleagues, or they do as they join the team. I think in the end, it's a matter of working in the communities and having the people in the communities actually doing that work and engaging. And where I think right now we're missing the boat is that we don't address the palatability of intervention points. We just say, this is the best intervention. Our models, the elasticity tells me that this is the place and how you want to intervene, even though that one may not be one that's palatable. So, and then we spend money on that one, which is often not the right one. There's a nice story about Nipah virus. I think we're out of time, but I could tell you over the break, but where the motivation really around disgust and people not wanting bats pooping in their drink was the motivation that stopped Nipah virus, not that they might die from Nipah virus. So you don't know until you hang out with people and you really figure out what it's all about. We didn't do that. That was a different group, but it's still a great story. Okay.
So I'll ask the non-science question.
Okay.
So how do you mobilize the politicians when most of the areas that need resources don't even have as much money as even a major city in the United States?
Yeah.
So I mean, in the end, it's about doing science and having a long-term point of view, and that gatekeeper is usually a politician.
Definitely. And I'm not sure I'm the best person to ask. I get in front of them, but I'm not sure that I do it well. You don't ever know, right? But I will say that politicians are people that are motivated by their constituencies, and the media, in my opinion, my whole job is to make this stuff sexy without scaring the crap crap out of people, right? But the media does a good job of that for us. So people are afraid of these things. So they complain to their Congress people or whatever. And so they want something. So whether or not a politician, him or herself, really believes that it's the best way to spend the money, if their constituency is pushing them to do something about this. You know, the amount of money we spent just when a single sick person came to Dallas is a big motivator as far as controlling that and thinking about what's all over the world and how they're moving. It seems nature keeps taking care of this issue for us with the politicians right now. I hope it doesn't keep doing that, but as we have Zika in Florida and it's coming through and we have the mosquitoes moving up into Northern California that can carry it, you know, that those all are sexy stories. I wish the sexy story was about building the lab and people could do it themselves, but it's really, people are afraid, and that keeps the politicians motivated for now. Their interest wanes until something bad happens, and then it comes back.
Okay, if there are any further questions, we have in the reception just across the hall now. And before we break for that, I'd like to call on Gordon Tate, who's the Central Veterinary Students Association president, to deliver his Schofield Medal.
Hi everyone. I just wanted to start off first by saying thank you so much for coming, and also a huge thank you to Dr. Jonna Mazet.
Thank you.
Such a great presentation. This is such a great opportunity for us to see really firsthand the interconnectedness between human and veterinary medicine, and it was an absolutely amazing lecture. I am honored to be able to present this award on behalf of the entire OVC community as well as its students. So without further ado,
thank you so much.
Schofield Medal, Dr. Jonna Mazet.
Thank you so much.
Nice to see you all.